1, 2, 3. Mike, 1, 2.
So kind to me. continual karma coming after me. There's no wall you won't keep down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, continual karma coming after me. There's no wall you won't keep down, lie you won't tear down.
Good evening, everybody. Welcome to Faith. We're looking forward to a wonderful time this evening as we continue the He is Risen services here. Before we get started and before the pastoral team comes out, I'm just going to invite those who are comfortably sitting towards the rear to make your way forward so we could fill the pews closer to the front. I think it's going to be a much warmer and spirit-filled experience as we make our way closer to the front. So if you'd kindly fill the first half of the pews coming up, nobody beyond the halfway point would certainly appreciate that as you make that adjustment. And we know that God is going to bless mightily as we worship Him this evening in spirit and in truth. So again, all those who are seated towards the rear, the halfway point, if you just kindly make your way closer to the front. Let's fill the pews that are closer to the front, and those who may be coming in a little later will have an easier time finding a seat there. We appreciate it. Thank you for making that adjustment for us.
Without hope, without light, to from heaven you came running, there was mercy in your eyes. To fulfill the law and prophets, to a virgin came the word. From a throne of endless glory, to a cradle in the dirt. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit.
Christ is born, and the Spirit lives and flames. Ladies and gentlemen, we're about to begin. And so I'm going to invite you to stand with me while we pray, please. Thank you, Mr. Musicians, for giving me some time here. Let's pray. Loving Father in heaven, we want to thank you for bringing us together tonight. We've come, and we know that you are already here waiting with a blessing for us. As we proceed with the meetings for tonight, we just ask that all things will be done to your honor and to your glory, that those who are on their way will get here so that together we can receive the blessing you have in store for us. Bless everything that takes place in this, your temple tonight. In the name of Jesus of Nazareth, we pray. Amen. Amen. Be seated, please. Be seated. This evening, I'd like to welcome all of you who have come. We know you certainly will not waste your time by coming here tonight. We know that the Lord has a blessing in store for each one of us. Those of us who were in the meeting last night could say that the presence of God was there. Last night we spent the evening at Shiloh in Springfield, and if you were not there, you missed something. Tonight we know that you are here, you will not miss it, because we are here and together we will enjoy and experience the blessings of heaven. I want to remind you that tomorrow night we will meet at this man's church at Hope. We'll meet in Hope tonight, tomorrow night. So we're inviting you to be there tomorrow night, and do not come alone, but bring some guests with you. Bring a family member, bring a friend with you, and let us together enjoy the blessings of heaven. So I want to welcome you, all of you, to our meeting tonight, and we know that God is here with a blessing for each one of you. The Lord bless you. Pastor Wright, come and welcome the folks.
Good evening, everyone. Good evening, everyone. It is so good to be in the house of God today. And listen, I am so excited. I'm excited about God and what He's doing for His people. The Bible says, oh, taste and see that the Lord is what, everybody? Wait a minute. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is what? Good. I'm going to tell you something. God is good. I want more than a taste tonight. Amen. How many of you want more than a taste? Amen. I'm looking for God to do some incredible things. As Pastor Madden has said, we kicked off our resurrection celebration on last night, on Friday night. And Pastor Madden, he didn't tell you, but he preached the word of God last night. I'm going to tell you something. It was a blast. You know, I love the Lord. How many of you love the Lord? Amen. And I'm so glad. Listen, if it wasn't for Jesus and the resurrection, guess what? The gospel would have no power. Amen. Because you know what? What good is it to live for Jesus and to keep His commandments and do all the things and eat right and do all the things that God has said we should do and then die and never live again? But that's not what the Bible tells us. The Bible tells us early Sunday morning, the Bible says, my God, my Savior, my friend, my Redeemer, He rose from the grave. Amen? And so if we should fall asleep in Jesus, guess what? Our names will be called. Amen. And we'll be changed in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye. And the Bible lets us know that we won't have bald heads anymore. No more glasses. Amen. No more broken teeth. Amen. Can somebody say amen? Amen. And so we are here tonight to celebrate God and what He is doing in God's people and in their lives. And so we're going to be concluding. I was thinking about tonight what I'm going to say. We're at the kind of the apex. We're at the top of the mountain right now. And Pastor Sturrup, the man of God, is going to come and share the word of God. I'm not going to introduce him because he doesn't need any introduction. Amen. His presentation will introduce himself. Amen. In the fact that he is filled with the Holy Ghost, God is using him in a mighty way here at the Faith Church and in the community of Hartford. We are privileged to have him here. Okay, let me say that again, Pastor. I need to say that again. We are privileged to have Pastor Sturrup here, working here in this part of the vineyard. Amen. Amen. I'm excited. I'm looking forward to him sharing the word of God with us tonight. And then tomorrow night at 7 p.m., we're going to be at the Hope Church. And yours truly, I'm going to be sharing the word of God. I guarantee you, I'm not going to be long. Somebody say yes. I'm not going to be long, but we're going to celebrate God. Amen. And what he's doing. Listen, if the world can celebrate God, surely we can. You know what? What's going to happen April 8th? What's going to happen April 8th? Did anybody know? The what? The solar eclipse, right? Do you know what they said on the news? They said millions of people are going to be flocking all over the place and spending millions of dollars just to see a dumb eclipse. Listen, listen, listen. I'm more excited about the coming of Jesus than a coming eclipse. Amen. And if the world can celebrate the fact that there's going to be an eclipse, surely I can celebrate God. Amen. What a wonderful God we serve. And I want to just take this opportunity again to welcome each one of you here tonight. You are in for a treat, and may God's presence rest upon us this day. Amen. Amen. Lift our voices, for it reaches to the highest mountain. Thank you, Lord, and it flows to the lowest valley. Gives me strength from day to day. It will never lose its power. Come on, one more time. If we can lift up our voices there. For it reaches to the highest. Highest mountain, and it flows
gives me strength from day to day. It will never, yes, it will never, no. We thank you for the sacrifice. I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you
came to save us.
One more time, sing, Lord. Lord, I lift your name on high. Can we lift him up in this place? Lord, I
love to sing your praises.
I'm
so glad you're in my life.
I'm so glad you came to
save us.
Oh, you came from heaven. You came from heaven to earth to show the way from the earth to the cross. My debt to pay from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. Sing, Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing.
Lord, I love to sing your praise.
It sounds good and it feels good. I'm so glad.
Yes.
Yes, God. I'm so glad you
came.
One more time, sing, Lord, I lift your name on high. We thank you for the sacrifice.
Lord, I love to sing your praise.
We love to glorify your name.
I'm so glad you're in my life.
I'm so very glad you are in my life.
I'm so glad you came to
Hallelujah.
Save
One more time, sing, Lord, I lift your name on
high.
We lift you up, God. Lord, and I'm so glad you came.
I'm so glad you came to serve.
Yeah, you came from heaven. You came from heaven to earth to show the way from the earth to the cross. My debt you paid from the cross, from the grave. Lord, I lift
your name on.
Oh, you came from heaven. You came from heaven to earth to show the way from the earth to the cross. My debt you paid from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on. Lift your voice, sing. You came from heaven.
You came from heaven
just to show us the way from. Yes, God, my debt you paid, yes. Oh, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name. One more time, say, you came from heaven above just to show us the way. Oh, from the earth to the cross, my debt you paid. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high.
Praise the Lord. So happy in Jesus. Amen. Puts a pep in your step, a glide in your stride. Amen. Would you stand with me as we open the scriptures together, as we contemplate this passage written by the Apostle Paul in his first epistle to the Corinthians. We're turning to 1 Corinthians chapter 15, and we will examine together, by the grace of God, verses 12 through 22. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 12 through 22. I'm going to be reading from the New King James Version of the Bible. Hear now the Apostle Paul to the Corinthians. Now, if Christ is preached that he has been raised from the dead, how do some among you say that there is no resurrection of the dead? But if there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ is not risen. And if Christ is not risen, then our preaching is empty, and your faith is also empty. Yes, and we are found false witnesses of God, because we have testified of God that he raised up Christ, whom he did not raise up, if in fact the dead do not rise. For if the dead do not rise, then Christ is not risen. And if Christ is not risen, your faith is futile. You are still in your sins. Then also those who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. And if in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men the most pitiable. But now Christ is risen from the dead and has become the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since by man death came, by man also came the resurrection of the dead. Verse 22 and last. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ all shall be made alive. Praise the Lord. This indeed is a powerful word from the Lord. May he add a blessing to the reading and understanding of his word. You may be seated. This is a point in the program where everybody has an opportunity to participate. I would like to invite our deacons, the deacons that are here, if you'd kindly retrieve our receptacles while we lift an evening offering. Every time we have an opportunity to raise an offering, it comes as an act of thanksgiving to God. It's an act that says, Lord, you have been better than good to me. You have kept me by your grace. You have supplied my every need. And as we return to the Lord, a portion of what he has given, I pray that the resurrection power that comes through knowing Christ will indeed revive us in every area of our lives. So as our officers come forward, we're going to invite you to dig deeply into your pockets and to bring an offering forth that will honor and please the Lord Jesus. For those who have cash with you, the offering plates are here. For those who would like to give online, we have on our screen the online giving option. If you go to our website, faithsdachurch.org, you will see an option for online giving, and we invite you to give your offerings that way as well. Shall we bow our heads as we thank God in advance for the gifts that we are about to receive? Let us pray. Father, the giver of every good and perfect gift, we praise you, we adore you, we thank you that we serve a risen Savior. Because of this, we are thankful, God, to cooperate with you in this work of reaching mankind with this life-saving, soul-changing message. I pray now that you'll bless the offerings, bless the givers, those who have, those who do not have. May we continue to give all to you, O God, until the day you come. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. When the praises go up,
when the praises go up, the blessings come down. When the praises go up, the blessings come down. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. When the praises go up, yes, the blessings come down. When the praises go up, the blessings come down. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
We're blessed, we're blessed, we're blessed.
Oh, we're blessed, we're blessed, we're blessed. We are blessed. We have food, clothing, and shelter. We are blessed. We're blessed, we're blessed, we're blessed. We are blessed. We don't deserve it, but yet we are blessed. We're blessed, we're blessed. We're blessed, we're blessed, we're blessed. We are blessed. We have food, clothing, and shelter. We are blessed. We're blessed, we're blessed, we're blessed. We are blessed. We don't deserve it, but yet we are blessed. When the praises go up, the blessings come down. When the praises go up, the blessings come down. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Amen.
Hallelujah. This is an important time of the year as we get to collectively commemorate the sacrifice of Jesus Christ, the one only begotten Son of God, the Father, and how he's grafted us in. Lord, we're grateful. And so we sing hallelujah. Hallelujah, for the Lord God Almighty reigns. Hallelujah, Lord, we love you. Hallelujah, for the Lord God Almighty reigns. Hallelujah. Holy, holy are you, Lord God Almighty. If we could lift our voice, sing hallelujah, hallelujah. Yes, Lord, we sing hallelujah, hallelujah, for the Lord God Almighty reigns. Sing hallelujah, yes, God. Hallelujah, hallelujah, for the Lord God Almighty, forever and ever you reign. Hallelujah, say hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. You are holy, holy, holy are you, Lord God. Thank you, Lord. Almighty, we sing, worthy is the Lamb. Oh, worthy is the Lamb. You are holy. And we lift up our hands in adoration for the sacrifice you made on you, Lord. You died for sinful man. You gave your life. Worthy. Worthy is the Lamb. We
sing amen, amen. Come on, one more time, if we could just give him the highest praise. Hallelujah. My God. We sing hallelujah. For the Lord God Almighty. Come on, lift your voice in here. Sing hallelujah. Hallelujah. We give it to you. Hallelujah. For the Lord. For the Lord reigns forever and ever. Hallelujah. We sing holy. Holy, holy, holy. We cry. Holy are you, Lord, Almighty Jesus. Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb. You are holy. Yes, you are. We give your name the praise, all the honor for the things you've done. Are you, Lord? Sin was too heavy, but you stepped in. God wrapped in flesh. Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy, worthy. Holy is the Lamb. Say, holy is the Lamb. Holy are you, Lord. A special, that's why I lift you up and I magnify your name. That's why my heart is filled with praise. If we could sing that one more time before we end. I love you. I love you. I love you, Lord. Every day, Lord God. But because you cared for each and every one of us, you know us by name. As you hung there on the cross and you sacrificed your life, that is why. Oh, and I lift you up and I magnify your name. Whoa. That's why heart is filled when I think of all the ways you've made. That's why my heart, that's why my heart is overflowing with my hands lifted up. I submit to your will. That's why my heart is filled with love for you, oh God. That's why my heart is filled. That is why my heart, that's why my heart is filled with praise.
Let the church say amen. Amen. Thank you so much, Brother Ronald and Sister Milka. By the way, today is Ronald's birthday. Can we just give God some praise for him coming out on his birthday night? to lift up the Lord in praise through singing. Just before we get into the word tonight, I want us to remember Dr. Stephen Williams in prayer. We were at Shiloh last night, and he was unable to be with us because he's under the weather. And so we just want to ask the church to remember him in prayer, that God will heal and restore his body. And as Dr. Wright said earlier, those of you who missed the message last night, you missed an exciting time in the Word. The senior pastor among us, Pastor Robert Madden, opened the Word of God and teached us last night. And we're so grateful for the way the Lord used him. I love to see the men of God blessed. Can we just put our hands together and give God thanks for Pastor Madden? And I also want to let you know that this weekend was the brainchild of Dr. Willie Wright. And he said, "Pastors, let's get together and do something for our congregations. Over the Easter weekend, why don't we feed the flock of God with his word and buoy their spirits up and do all that we can to be a blessing to them over this weekend?" And I always say that we must never despise small beginnings. I can't wait for next year when we're able to do this again, and we would have gotten out of the gate and others would be able to see the vision, how it can bless us when we come together on a weekend like this, where most people around the world that accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior commemorate the fact that he rose from the dead. And this is something good. If you agree with me, would you say amen? Amen. This is something good, Dr. Wright, and we need to build on this. And each year we want every rung to go higher and higher. I want to say a special thank you to the members of the Faith Church who made it back. We just got out of divine service a few minutes ago. Our service was extended today, and some of them went home and made it back, and I'm really, really grateful for that. But we had an amazing time here today. And then to the members of Charity, Hope, and Shiloh, welcome to the Faith Seventh-day Adventist Church. I refer to it as the best church in the world, and you can understand it because every pastor feels that way about their congregation. I'm just one of those who have the stomach to say so. Welcome to the best church in the world, and I pray that you are blessed as we worship together. Tonight I want to speak on the subject, the power of his resurrection, meaning Christ, the power of his resurrection. And if you're physically able, I'm going to ask you to stand just for a moment so that we can read the scripture again. And in reverence to the word of God, I'm going to ask you to stand. Those of you who may have missed it the first time, you will be able to participate this time. I'm going to read in your hearing from the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 12 to 22, and I'm reading from the King James Version of the Bible. And it says, "Now if Christ be preached that he rose from the dead, how say some among you that there is no resurrection of the dead? But if there be no resurrection of the dead, then Christ is not risen. And if Christ be not risen, then our preaching is vain, and your faith is also vain. Yea, we are found false witnesses of God, because we have testified of God that he raised up Christ, whom he raised not up. If so, be that the dead rise not. For if the dead rise not, then Christ is not raised. And if Christ is not raised, then your faith is vain, and you're still in your sins. Then they also which are fallen asleep in Christ are perished. In this life only, if all we have is hope in Christ without a resurrection, we are of all men most miserable. But now is Christ risen from the dead and become the first fruits of them that slept. For since by man came death, by man came also the resurrection of the dead. For as all in Adam die, even so in Christ shall all be made alive. This is the reading of the word of the Lord. Father, speak to our hearts tonight, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. After the Corinthian church was raised up, and the church started to grow and experience the power of God among the people, an argument arose where one of the teachers in the Corinthian church said that this idea that Christ is risen from the dead is not so. The Apostle Paul, getting wind of this, decided to write a letter to the Corinthian church, wondering how, after all the power they have experienced, having a relationship with Jesus, how could they come to the conclusion that Jesus had never risen from the grave? And so he writes this letter to them, helping them to understand that the resurrection of Jesus Christ is one of the most critical pillars in the faith of the believer. Let me say that again. He wanted them to know that the resurrection of Jesus Christ is one of the most critical pillars in the faith of the believer. In fact, it is so critical that Paul says that if Christ has not risen from the dead, then our preaching is in vain. He goes on to say that if Christ has not risen from the dead, then our faith is in vain. If Christ is not risen from the dead, then we are still in our sins. So all this thing that we call church and worship and serving, all of it amounts to naught if Christ has not risen from the dead. And this is the reason why I am glad to be a Seventh-day Adventist preacher. Let me tell you why. Because for Seventh-day Adventists, the doctrine of the sanctuary is pivotal. Somebody open their mouth and say amen. You see, it's not only about a lamb without blemish being sacrificed, but it also tells us who the lamb is. The Lamb is Jesus Christ himself. But after the Lamb was sacrificed, We learned from the doctrine of the sanctuary that we needed a living priest to now apply the blood. And if Christ is only the lamb that died, then it means that we lack a living priest. But Jesus is not only the lamb, he is also our high priest. Would you say amen? Which means that he died, then he rose from the dead. He is also the priest in the sanctuary. We have no priest other than Jesus who is worthy to enter the Holy of Holies. In the earthly sanctuary, on the Day of Atonement, when the priests went into the most holy place, they had to tie a rope around his waist. And they had a special robe that he wore on that day that had bells down at the bottom of the garment. The rope was tied to him because if he went into the most holy place with one unconfessed sin and stood in the presence of the Shekinah glory of God, he would have died immediately, and the rope was tied around his waist to drag him out. The bells was attached to the garment so that as he moved doing his work in the most holy place, they could hear the bell ringing and they would know that he is still alive. Which helps me to appreciate the fact that no human being can truly atone for my sins because all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. But there's one called Jesus Christ who is my righteous sacrifice. He is without blemish. He is without sin. He needs no rope around his garment and he needs no bells at the bottom of his robe. When he steps into the most holy place to do his work, he's able to do it because his sacrifice was sufficient for God. It is fully accepted, and now he can mediate on my behalf and your behalf. On that day called the Day of Atonement, judgment took place. And I'm going to give you the shortened version of why I am assured that Jesus Christ, the dying lamb, is also Jesus Christ, the risen priest. On the Day of Atonement, there were two animals as a part of the service. One was the Lamb of God, and one was the scapegoat. And I want you to know tonight how important the resurrection is. In the sanctuary, it teaches us that every sin ever committed under the sun is going to hell. You hear what I just said? Every single sin I have ever committed, every single sin you have ever committed, all sin will be burnt in the fires of hell. Every single sin is going to hell. But there was a lamb, and the lamb was slain, and the blood of that lamb was applied to every sin that was ever confessed, and it represented the fact that the blood of Jesus Christ would be able to wash away all of my confessed sins. And this is why the Bible says, if any man sins, let him confess his sin. And God is faithful and just to forgive those sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. But then there was the scapegoat. The scapegoat was there for all confessed sins. So every sin I have ever committed and confess, those sins would be tied on the head of the scapegoat. I'm going a little bit ahead of myself. So the blood was sprinkled from the lamb, was sprinkled on a veil in the temple every day of the year. On the Day of Atonement, the priest would come out and hold up that veil. Now imagine putting blood on a white piece of cloth for an entire year. You must know how that would look. Just demonstrating how filthy sin looks in the presence of God. But even though it was filthy, it represented sins that were confessed. The priest would then take that veil and tie it around the head of the scapegoat, and the scapegoat will wander into the wilderness and die. Here's the symbolism. When we confess our sins to God, our living priest applies his blood, and every sin that was confessed will be tied not upon the head of a scapegoat, but upon the head of the devil. Because every sin ever committed under heaven is going to hell. When the sin is tied upon the head of the devil, he will carry my sins to hell for me. Now, you just missed a good place to say amen. Because if the devil doesn't carry your sins to hell for you, then you have to carry it yourself. Let me say it again. Every sin ever committed under heaven is going to hell, and it's going to burn. Now, I have made up my mind that I'm not going to carry my sins to hell myself. I'm going to confess them to God, and my risen priest is going to apply his blood to my sins, and Satan will have to carry my sins to hell for me. If I do not confess my sins, then I got to carry them myself. The power of the resurrection of Jesus Christ allows me to fall on my knees and say, Father, I stretch my hands to thee. No other help I have. The resurrection of Jesus Christ allows him to sit at the right hand of the Father, our mediator next to God. And every single time I commit a sin, I am in a hurry to confess the sins that I am aware of and the sins that I am unaware of. Why? Because my living priest would allow my sins to go to hell with somebody else, and I don't have to carry it by myself. The resurrection of Jesus Christ then guarantees my resurrection. Because there's no resurrection for me if my sins are unconfessed. But if I confess my sins, he is faithful and just to forgive me of those sins and to cleanse me from all unrighteousness. So the day I die, I can die with the faith and the hope and the assurance that the same Jesus who raised Lazarus from the dead is able to raise me from the dead as well. When Lazarus was ill, he intentionally came to Bethany 4 days late. He runs into one of the sisters of Lazarus who is angry with him. She wasn't testifying. She was rowing Jesus when she said to him, if you were here, my brother would not have died. I know we like to make everybody in the Bible song holy and, you know, saints. folk in the Bible had feelings too. And she was angry that her brother died. And she said to Jesus, if you were here, my brother would not have died. Jesus says, don't worry about it. Your brother's going to live again. And she says, yeah. You talking about the resurrection. But you're not going to do that until later. And Jesus had to remind Martha, Martha, I don't do resurrection. I am the resurrection and the life. And he goes to the tomb, calls Lazarus from the dead, and tell the grave workers to loose him and let him go. Now, how does that guarantee my resurrection? If he did it before, he can do it again. But he went on to demonstrate that he is not only limited to raising other people from the grave, but he demonstrated that he can raise himself from the grave. The nails did not take his life. The spear in his side did not take his life. He declared something that no one else could declare. I lay down my life, and when I'm good and ready, I'm going to take it up again, and there's no power on earth that can keep me down. The resurrection of Jesus Christ guarantees the resurrection of every believer whose sins have been confessed. You see, when it comes to death for the believer, death does not mean that God is no longer in control of the matter. We are the only people on the face of the earth. I shared this with this congregation at Faith before. We are the only group of people, Christian believers, who live in a win-win-win-win situation. There's no losing with God. If you are sick, God can heal you. If you're sick and God doesn't heal you, he can raise you from the dead. And when he raises you from the dead, he raises you from the dead never to die again. And when he raises you from the dead never to die again, you will never grow old. Your amen sound a little sorry tonight. I said, if you're sick, he can heal you. You win. But if you die, he can resurrect you. You just won again. And when he resurrects you, you will never die again. You won again. But when he resurrects you, you will never grow old. You will be able to run and not get weary and walk and not faint. Now, if we got some young folk in the audience, they won't understand what I'm about to say. But when I was younger, I loved to play basketball. I could play basketball all day outside in the summer without drinking water. Now at 57, I can watch other people play basketball all day in the sun without drinking water. The other day I was on the basketball court in the gym next door and I tried to run and I was reminded, they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. I can't do it anymore now But as I cast my eyes to the future, there's going to be a day when I will be able to run again. There'll be a day when my health and my strength would be revived and renewed. There will be a day again when I will never grow old. And all of this is a result of the fact that Jesus Christ was risen from the dead. In fact, I look forward to the resurrection. I look forward. I'm not one of those pastors who want to live forever down here. I want to live forever when Jesus receives me as his own in another place, in another time. But I'm not afraid of death. Not afraid of it. Listen. Jesus says to the believer, I got you. He says, this thing called death, I've been there and I've done that. And it ain't so bad. He said, I know what it feels like when a person dies. About 15 minutes to an hour and 20 minutes after a person dies, they begin to turn pale. It's called pallor mortis. Jesus says, I went through that. After that, something happens to the remains of the body called alga mortis, where the body begins to reduce its temperature and you're no longer warm, you begin to turn cold. Jesus says, I've been through that. About 4 hours after death, something else happens. It's called rigor mortis, where the limbs of the corpse become stiff. It's difficult to move or manipulate. Jesus says, been there, done that. And then after that, you go through something called liver mortis, where the blood begins to settle at the lowest points in your body and discoloration takes place. Jesus says, been there, done that too. And it wasn't so bad. In fact, Jesus could have resurrected himself while he was still on the cross. But they would have said he never really died. He could have resurrected himself when they took him down from the cross, but then they would have said he wasn't stiff yet. Well, Saturday was out of the picture because the Bible tells us, Luke chapter 23 and verse 56, that the ladies who wanted to put spices around the tomb, they returned and prepared spices and ointments, but then they rested the Sabbath day according to the commandments. So he wasn't getting up on the Sabbath because that was his day of rest. Can I get an amen? But early on Sunday morning, early on Sunday morning, he decided to wait until they put him in the tomb and seal it. And let me tell you something about the sealing of the tomb of Jesus. It was not just a large stone that they put in front of the tomb of Jesus. The stone that they put in front of the tomb of Jesus was on an angle, like this. So once his body was in there, they removed something from in front of the rock and it rolled down the incline into position. And in order to move that stone again, you had to push it up, which was almost an impossible task. They thought that by putting that stone that rolled down into place and lock could keep Jesus in the tomb. They didn't recognize that all power was given to this man called Jesus in heaven and in earth.
and there is no stone that's big enough or no stone that you can lock in place that can keep my Jesus in the tomb. I said early on Sunday morning, he got up, and here is where most Christians miss the essence of the resurrection. They place as much emphasis on the day of the resurrection as they place on the resurrection of Jesus himself, and as a result, many now worship on the first day of the week because that was the day that Jesus rose on. The truth is, Jesus never blessed, rested upon, or sanctified any other day than the seventh day of the week, which is his holy Sabbath day. So let me just help you to appreciate something about the resurrection as I close. The Bible is the will of God. Can I get an amen? Amen? What do I mean by this? The Apostle Paul tells us that the Scriptures, it is the will of God. Hebrews chapter 9, verse 16 and 17. For where there is a testament, there must also of necessity be the death of the testator. For a testament is a force after men are dead. Otherwise, it is of no strength at all while the testator liveth. That's legal language. Any lawyer in the audience would recognize what I just read to you from Hebrews chapter 9, verse 16 and 17. Let me break it down for you. If the Scriptures is the will, whenever you go to a lawyer, anything that belongs to you, you have a right to say that this is my last will and testament. You put everything that you want in your will before you die. Because after you die, the will is sealed. As long as you are alive, you can change your will as much as you want, but after you die, anybody who tries to change your will, they're tampering with your wishes. Before Jesus went to Calvary and died, he took some things out of his will and he put some stuff into his will. Let me break it down for you. Before he went to Calvary and died, he brought an end to sacrifices and oblations. The reason you don't bring a lamb to church when you come now is because that's no longer in the will. When he died on Calvary, he said, I am the Lamb of God. The animal and its blood could have never really washed away your sins. It was just a shadow of something to come. That's no longer in the will. In fact, when he was on Calvary, the high priest was at the temple about to slay the Passover lamb. And when he was in the holy place about to do that, Jesus cried out from Calvary. And the Bible says that the veil in the temple was rent in two from top to bottom. And for the first time, the most holy place in the temple on earth was exposed. The Shekinah glory was no longer there. And Jesus was the Lamb of God. So bringing the sheep to the sanctuary was taken out of the will. Before Jesus died, he endorsed baptism. It wasn't always in the will, but he endorsed it. He went down to the Jordan River, and when John saw him, John said, "Behold the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world." Jesus stepped down into the Jordan River, and he said, "John, baptize me." And John says, "I need to be baptized of you." He said, "No, I want you to baptize me because I'm putting this in the will. And anybody who will come into the kingdom of God must be born again of the water and of the Spirit." He added it in the will. I can go on from illustration to illustration. Before he died, he instituted what we call the communion service. He said, "Take this bread and eat it, and take this cup and drink it. It represents my body that has been broken for you." And the blood represents, and the drink represents the blood that was shed for us on Calvary. When he died on Calvary, the will was closed. And because he knew that men would tamper with his will, Jesus is a bad dude. Because he knew that men would tamper with his will, he sealed his will, he died, and he got up to make sure that when they tamper with it, he will be inspiring others to continue to write to make sure that the will is not changed. When you and I die, we can't get up to hold our will in place, but Jesus not only died, he got up from the grave to enforce his will. The resurrection helps us to appreciate that anything that Jesus did not put in the will came too late. If he wanted us to worship on the day of his resurrection, he would have put that in the will before he died. If you try to change it after he, in fact, he rested in the tomb on the Sabbath day to ensure that he kept his will even in death, and got up on the Sunday morning. So those who go to church every Sunday morning, you may be worshiping God, but that's not a part of the will. It came too late. There's so many things that's happening in the church today, but it came too late. That's why the scriptures have been preserved for our learning, so that we can study the will of God for ourselves. Would you say amen to that? Somebody asked me the question not so long ago, "Pastor, if two persons of the same gender come to you and ask you to marry them, would you do it?" And I responded by asking, "Is it in the will? If it's not in the will, I can't do it." "Oh, but you would be violating their rights." "Oh, I may be violating their rights, but if I do it, then they'll be violating my rights. Their rights are not more important than my rights. In fact, when I am doing the will of God, I am right." And the day will come when doing the will of God will cause many of us to be persecuted and to be put in jail, and some of us will lose our lives. But it doesn't matter, because the resurrection is assured. Any Christian who's afraid of death does not understand the power of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And I will tell you, as I stand before you tonight, my wife can tell you, I'm always practicing my resurrection move. When I go to sleep at night sometime, I'm dreaming about my resurrection move. Because if I am not translated, when the trumpets sound by the grace of God, I want to be in that first resurrection. What about you out there? And God has made a way through the Lamb of God. Jesus Christ, my righteous sacrifice. Every time I go to a funeral and I look into the eyes of the remaining loved ones and I see the tears, I'm encouraged to know that one day, and I pray that it would be soon, that God is going to wipe away all of those tears. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye. In fact, the Bible tells us when it's going to happen: at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and this mortal will put on immortality, and this corruptible will put on incorruption. And then shall the saying be brought to pass: O death, where is your sting? O grave, where is your victory? Thanks be to God that we have the victory because of the power of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Do you receive the word of the Lord tonight? Come on, brothers and sisters, do you receive the word of the Lord tonight? There was a debate in Corinth about whether or not Jesus had risen from the dead. There's no debate among his people today. He is risen. He is risen. I serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. And because he lives, I can face tomorrow. I invite you to stand to your feet at this time if you believe that Jesus has risen from the grave. He's alive and well, and he's our intercessor in the heavenly sanctuary. If you believe that tonight, stand to your feet. If you believe that tonight, I want somebody to shout hallelujah. I want somebody to shout thank you, Jesus. I need somebody to shout praise the Lord tonight. We serve a risen Savior. And because of him, heaven can be my home as long as I do not tamper with his will. I serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. I know
that he is living, whatever man may say.
I see his hands of mercy.
I see his hand of mercy. I hear his voice of cheer.
And just the time
and just
that I need him,
I need him,
he's always there.
He's always
come on, people of God, let's sing it now. He lives. Christ Jesus, lives today.
He walks with me and he talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives.
There may be one person here tonight who has not accepted this risen Savior as your Lord. And I cannot end this meeting tonight, this worship service tonight, without giving you an opportunity to receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and personal Savior. Or there may be somebody here tonight who once walked with Jesus, but you
are in a backslidden condition. I've got good news for you. If you backslide, you can slide back. And Jesus will receive you with arms of love as if you have never sinned before. Is there anybody in this house of worship tonight who have never received Jesus as Lord and Savior, or you're not in a right relationship with him right now? You could just raise your hand right where you are. He'll see your hand and he'll receive you. And when the veil is tied upon the head of the scapegoat, who's Satan, and those sins are going to hell to be burnt, you don't have to carry it yourself. The devil can carry your sins for you. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Let us pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for your word tonight. I pray, O God, that it was presented with clarity and simplicity that even the smallest child in the room would have understood. Thank you. Thank you for expanding your kingdom and allowing us to be a part. Now, Father, as you've commissioned us to go and tell others about you, as you've commissioned us to tell others about Jesus, as you've commissioned us to receive the power of the Holy Spirit to be your witnesses, may the Shiloh Church and the Hope Church and the Charity Church and the Faith Church become brighter beacons of light in the communities where you've placed us, so that people all around us who are dying without Christ in their lives would be close enough so that when we throw out the lifeline, we will become fishers of men. And all who could be saved through our efforts will be saved by your grace, your mercy, and your power. For these things we ask in Jesus' name. Let the people of God say amen. Come on, put your hands together. Let's give God some praise in his sanctuary as Dr. Wright comes to bring this service to a close. Come on, come on now. You know when you're in the world, you clap better than that. And please don't tell me I preach too long, because when you're in the world, you were just getting ready to go to the disco right now. Let's give God a round of applause. Let's put our hands together. Clap your hands, all ye people. Now let's praise the Lord as we prepare to leave this place in his grace and power.
You may be seated. Surely we have experienced the presence of God here today and felt the presence of God here today. If you've been blessed, why don't you say amen? Amen. We're going to conclude our celebration of the resurrection of Christ and what he has done for me. And we're going, for us, should I say, and for me, we're going to conclude tomorrow at 7 p.m. right at the Hope Church. We want to encourage you to come as we come to a crescendo, a climax, and we're going to, I believe it's going to take us through the rest of this year. Amen? How many of you enjoyed this celebration this weekend? I think, Pastor, we need to do it again. I think we need to do it again and ramp it up just a little bit more so that we can help others who may not be aware that Jesus is risen and that he is alive. Let's sing that stanza of one, that song that Pastor was singing. We serve a risen Savior. Let's stand, everybody. Let's stand. Just one stanza of that, and then we can say goodbye.
I serve a risen Savior, he's in the world today. I know that he is living, whatever man may say. I see his hand of mercy, I hear his voice of cheer. And just the time I need him, he's always near. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks. walks with me, and he talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives. He lives within my heart.
Goodbye, everybody. God bless you. We'll see you tomorrow night at 7 p.m. right at the Hope Church. Turn to the person next to you and say how glad you were happy to be here today. Amen. Amen. God bless you. You are dismissed.
enough for